This is our baptism day, very important day. Isabel will be baptized soon, and she's so very young. And so we instinctively ask ourselves, what will the rest of her life be like? Where will she go? What will she do? How will she turn out? But you know, way beyond what she may do, what her career may be, what we want for Isabel is to make the Christian connections, make the connections to Jesus as she gets older, and I'm sure she will with her lovely parents. Because there is really only one question that she needs, or any of us will ultimately need to answer in life, and that is, what is my reaction when I'm confronted by God in Jesus Christ? And that is the core of the gospel. We need to turn to Christ. And we see here that our deepest questions will get answered, and we will acquire something vastly more than all this world can give us. More than our bank accounts, more than we can imagine, because we get to the truth and we get to the knowledge that is most central to our deepest human longings. And so today we see that Isabel will make those connections. She'll start today with baptism right here, and she will take a journey to Jesus Christ. And here it starts, where Jesus says, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you. And he waits to hear Isabel say, yes, Lord, I love you too. Well, I don't know about you, but I opened the newspaper yesterday. I usually do it on Saturday night. And I wondered whether that was a very good pastime. But I opened up the newspaper and I found out that in some place at work, they just put a chip in you, and instead of sort of signing in, so to speak, you just scan it. My goodness gracious. I don't know about Anne and Kim, but we're going to scan in to work. And then, of course, I turned over to the international news, and I was reminded of how far missiles can go. I thought, oh my goodness gracious. And so they can go very far, I was taught. And so I thought to myself, oh my goodness me, what is the world coming to? And then here I was to preach and to bridge that gap between the gospel and today's society. How can we possibly do it as Christians? But of course, here we see Christ in his majesty, in his awesome power as king and ruler of the universe. Privately, he comes to the disciples walking on the water. Now, I don't know if it's possible to have a picture up there, but I did ask. Here we are. And here we are, we see Jesus coming to the beloved disciples. You know, he's just fed the 5,000. 5,000 men, and then maybe it'd be many more, maybe even 15,000 people. And so he made the disciples get into the boat, and he kind of, you can just see him pushing them up. I'm going up the mountain to pray. I'll meet you later in Capernaum. Off you go. And he goes up to pray, and of course Christ is seeing us, and he's seeing the disciples. And he knows that they're battling the wind, because one of those notorious squalls comes up as quickly as a blink of an eye, and there they are rowing, and they've got a miniature sail there.
and they are in the full force of the storm. And Jesus, having finished praying, walks across the lake, walks across the sea, and they are terrified, because when they see him, they think it's a ghost. Now in Mark's gospel, we read in Mark 6 that Jesus went to pass them by. Well, what does really, was he taking a shortcut and going to get there first? Because he was just passing them by? But no, we learn in Job and in Exodus and in Kings, we learn in Job chapter 9, we see that Job, with all his frustrations, he wants to see God. He wants to make his case before God. What is going on, Lord, with my life? We get all, well, I know you are the majestic. We know you created the mountains. We know you created the sea and let you walk on the sea. But every time I want to see you and perceive you, I cannot see you. And you know that edge of I want to see God, I cannot see you. And in Exodus 33, after Aaron has just allowed this golden calf, Moses is frustrated. I'm sure the dear Lord is beside himself with his people of Israel. And Moses, too, wants to see God. So in Exodus 33, God puts him in where he stands on the mountain and he's protected with a cleft. And the Lord passes by. Moses is only allowed to see the back of God, because if he was to see him face to face, he would surely die. And Elisha too, he too is only allowed to see God passing by and not see his face. But Jesus is on the sea, and where it says it seems as though he passes by, because Jesus was passing by, but then revealed his face to the apostles. He revealed his face to the people. God's face is revealed to the people. And so this is nonetheless when God, who in all his majesty in all the universe, is walking on the water. But he created the water. And if you notice this beautiful picture, I have one here. I'll just allow it to pass around. You can see his feet. His feet, he's above the storm. He is riding the storm. He is over the storm. And we know that in the storms of life that Jesus sees us and he is with us. Very specifically, he comes to them and he says, "Take courage, it is I." And that is the Old Testament word. It is, I am who I am. We're reminded again of Exodus, Moses at the burning bush, who takes off his shoes. Well, who are you? Well, I am who I am. I do not change. Well, who shall I say sent me when I talk to Pharaoh? Moses was making every excuse possible not to go back. Lord God said, if I am who I am, I existed before, I am. So that is the name of God, of Yahweh. And Christ says, it is I. That is the name for God, I am who I am. It is I. It's not a ghost. So then he comes to them. Peter says, well, if it's you bid me come. Well, I don't know if you've ever got out of a boat in the middle of Lake Ontario or anywhere else for that matter, but it is an enormous effort. You've got to get up. You've got to put your foot over. And then, oh my goodness, you know, all of us, we jump through the water, don't we, to land on maybe sand or rocky shore in order to go up the beach. We've all done this. But then, nowhere near that, Peter is totally out of his comfort zone. I don't know what got into Peter, but he knew it was Jesus, And he looks at Jesus and he gets out. Oh my gosh. He's walking on water. And there's no turning back now. He's a changed person. How many people walked on water? No, not just Jesus. Peter. You know, I think Christ, in the storms, we all have storms of life. Isabel will have storms of life. And she is encouraged as she makes that journey to Christ to get out of the boat. You don't get out of the boat. You've got to get out of the boat. We Christians are a little bit, we want to stay in our comfort zone, don't we? Do you think I really enjoy here speaking to all of you? I'm terrified. I have to get out of the boat. Lord, you must be joking. But we all have to do it. And I know some of you are not well, and you have to go to hospital. And I know that we need to take courage. And it is difficult. It is very, very difficult, this life. And we need Jesus, and Isabel will need Jesus on her journey. And guess what? Peter realized he was walking. Oh my gosh! As soon as he took his eyes off Jesus, he became a sodden Peter. And you know something? The Prince of Apostles teaches us that when we do that, when we sort of, can I say it, fail, and we're starting to go down, we need to cry, Lord, save me! And he touches us, and we're right up there. And we're with Jesus, and Isabel will need to do that in her journey. She's very, very young now, but in her journey. Now what she will be, what her career will be, I don't know. Evan's a farmer, maybe she'll be a farmer. Maybe she'll be the chief of farm personnel. Whatever she role she takes on and makes those Christian connections to Christ, as Peter did. You know, when we step out of the boat, there's an enormous amount of fear. Does that make any sense? To go out of our comfort, enormous fear. I remember when I was down in Urbana, I heard Elizabeth Elliot, her husband, had gone down to Ecuador, and he had been martyred. And she was telling this conference hall of thousands of students that when she was consumed with fear. Whenever she wanted to do something, she had fear. And one day her friend came to her and said, you're to feel the fear, but to keep going, and to do that which the Lord wants you to do, to push through that fear with Jesus, just as Peter has done. Yes, we need to touch Jesus. And at the end of the Gospel of chapter 14, we're reminded that yes, Jesus fed the 5,000. He fed them. All that he touched, the crust of bread, were filled up, were hungry no more. And Peter touches Christ, and he is raised up. And we are raised up when we come to Holy Communion, that we too need Jesus. We need to take him, we need to touch him, and we need to express our faith in this world, which is a very difficult world to live in. It's a very hard world. And we pray that Isabel, pretty good, huh? I think she's walking on water right there. Looking very, very beautiful. And it's a great privilege. And as a community, we bring her to Christ through our prayer. Let us pray now. Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you for this marvelous day. We thank you that you are Lord of the universe. you are in control. Lord Jesus Christ, we come to you and we touch you. We touch you in faith as you ask us to get out of the boat, whether that means going to hospital or being unemployed, having financial difficulties, or even in a hospice. We ask, Lord Jesus Christ, that you would watch over us, that you would be with us, that you would walk with us, that you would love us, that we may know this. And we pray especially for Isabel on this very precious day of a start, of a journey into the hands of Jesus Christ. Thank you. In Jesus, we pray. Amen.